So the Summer of the Beautiful White Horse, the first chapter from your book, Snapshots. And this chapter, what is it? It's a childhood adventure. Children here, these two boys, Aram and Murad, they are cousins. And they belong to the Garofalian tribe. These are things that you have to remember. So these two boys, they belong to Garofalian tribe. Once upon a time, it was very prosperous. The tribe was there. The tribe that they belonged to, it was prosperous. But with the passage of time, many things changed. And now what has happened, they had to leave their country and they've come to, like they are here in America. And they're talking about that how they're living in a state of almost poverty, right? As compared to the kind of life that they had earlier. But one thing that is there, during the time when their tribe was there, rich and prosperous, that time also it was known for its honesty, right? And even now, in spite of the poverty they are living in, this tribe is known for its honesty. So even though they have fallen on bad times, life is difficult for them, but what is one quality that they have not given up? That is, they have not, you know, tarnished or hurt their reputation, okay? Now in this story, it's a very simple childhood experience, right? Like, you know, as you have grown up now, you're in class 11th and before that you had your results. And you used to get, you know, like, yes, lots of lectures and lessons regarding your board exams and your friends, relatives telling you that, okay, you had a reputation to live up to. Your cousin scored this much, you had to score more or the same, isn't it? Right? And of course, you are also there, like if your parents are doctors, you're supposed to work hard. And you have to live up to the family name so that you can also pursue your medical degree, isn't it? So right from our childhood, in some way or the other, we have that, you know, like people have expectations from us, right? So if I talk about like, okay, I enter the class, I look at one or two students and I'm discussing about tests, I'm discussing about work. And then of course, when I'm going through the answer sheets, right? So I think about one or two students. Say maybe I'm checking Megha's notebook. I always expect her to do well. And if there's some mistake, I'll definitely ask her what happened, right? Why you didn't get it right? Or what was it that you did not learn? Why this mistake? And on the other hand, there might be someone like, okay, I won't take the name, that I pick up that notebook, I pick up the answer sheet, and I think, okay, this person is never going to work hard. It's always going to be like this. So we have expectations in almost every sphere, right? So whether that's home, in school, society. The problem is, yes, living up to those expectations. But sometimes, on the other hand, I would say that if you have this reputation before you, that look at him, he's roaming around here and there, and look at her, look like you can say, and her family is there, very educated and reputed. And of course, so everybody has a lot of expectations, right? Sometimes it keeps you in check also. It helps you to maintain that check in life. So we don't exceed maybe our limits, right? So sometimes it does serve as a check. But here, these two young boys, what did they do that their conscience reminded them that this is not what our family does, right? So here in this story, Aram and Murad, they both, which tribe do they belong to? They belong to the Garofalian tribe. Please remember this name. Murad is there. They're all here, you know, like, yes. As I told you, they have fallen on bad times. They're living under very poverty-stricken conditions. But they have not given up that, you know, zeal for living. They have that liveliness. They have So everyone has qualities. Now, if you look among your cousins also, when your family is there together at social gatherings and all, so one odd cousin is always there. You feel like, oh my God, I would like to be like him or her when I grow up, isn't it? Yes, so you have someone you really look up to. And you have someone who's there always cracking jokes and making fun, and we like such people. So even though we might not be, you know, like, yes, sir, meeting each other, but we are aware that yes, these people are there and they have these qualities and traits. Now, Adam and Murad. Murad is the elder cousin, right? Teenager. And he has a love for animals. He's crazy about animals. And it seems as if he has a way with animals. As we read the chapter, we'll find him, you know, treating the broken wing of a bird, right? He has a way with dogs, and generally what happens in the middle of the night, or you go to, you know, like a secluded place, and dogs are there, immediately start barking. But Murad was such a person, he had such a love for animals that no, they would just leave him alone. They would not bark at him. Now, how does the problem begin? The problem begins that when Adam wakes up one day, early morning, it's not even a proper daylight, and he sees his cousin standing outside the window, and he's riding a horse, right? And he's very surprised. Why? To see that Murad is there riding the horse, because their family cannot afford to buy a horse. That means, where has he got that from? Has he stolen it? No, he can't steal it, because they are known for their honesty, right? So it's just like you, you know, like, of course, your parents are away, and you just learned how to drive the car, and your friend comes over and you say, okay, let's go for a ride. I can drive. Done that ever? And then what happens is that, yeah, you were feeling very brave and very confident, but kids are kids. What happened on the road? You met with a minor accident. There are little scratches now. Very difficult to hide. How are you going to explain that? Right? So, of course, very, you know, obediently, you keep the car back and you keep on waiting. Okay, when are my parents going to notice? Are you going to confess? Or are you going to wait for them and let that moment pass as much as it can? Happens? Happens? Yes, it does. We've all done this, right? Sometime or the other, we feel very grown up, and you know, we try to feel responsible. But certain things, they keep on reminding us that we have a lot to learn. Now, what has happened is that Adam, when he looks at his cousin, he's so surprised to see him. Where did he get this horse from? We can't buy a horse, right? So where is he? That means he's stolen it. But he cannot believe that his cousin has done such a thing, because he really looks up to his cousin. He's his idol, you know. And then, Murad asks him that, do you want to go with me to ride the horse? And he's ready to accompany him. And they both go for horse riding. And when Murad rides the horse. So when you go for your trips to the hill station and other places, have you ever tried riding a horse? So when you were there in your childhood days, it was a must. You go into a hill station and that man would, you know, like, of course, a small circle would be there and he'll help you around, right? Independently, have you tried? Yes. How difficult it is to control a horse. It's not difficult. It is there. And of course, it's a very intelligent animal. It senses that this person is new, confident, comfortable, uncomfortable, isn't it? And of course, yeah, right. Of course, initially when it starts, that trot is there. And when it gets into a gallop, that fast, then that is a little scary. And of course, yes, when we talk about horsepower, there's something really worth talking about. Now here, when Murad was there riding the horse had no problem with Murad, right? He ran across the fields and whatever came in the way, and he had a nice long ride. Then Adam said, even I want to ride the horse on my own. Murad allowed him to. But the moment Adam sat on the horse, horse realized that this is a new person, a new learner. What did he do? He threw him down and ran off. Right? So the boys went chasing the horse, and from quite a distance, they had to bring him back. Now, in this family, there is one more member. I'm telling you the story today, and I expect you to read it at home, because you people are there without the books. Right? So students at home can see the screen and with you all. So once again, if I had been aware of it, yes, I definitely would have made arrangement with the projector and all. Now, there is one person, Uncle Khosrow. He has a, you know, like, he's, as you say, least concerned about what is happening. Right? Why? Because he has seen those times when his family was there going through good times. And now when they're going through these bad, rough patches of life, it seems as if he has not really come. And he thinks that I am the one who has suffered the most. No one has a bigger problem than me. We have people like that. Yes. Have you ever come across such people? Right. Okay. And they start discussing their problems. Right. You have a problem. You've hurt yourself, or maybe you have fever. You're not feeling well. Instead of asking about your health and asking about your foot or whatever, they start discussing their problems. That what happened to me was much, much bad than what has happened to you. Now, Uncle Khosrow here, he's least bothered about what is happening, right? And once his house also caught fire, when someone came telling him, right? He had just one response, right? So pay no attention, right? So he was least bothered about what is happening in his life. Now, Uncle Khosrow was known for his crazy streak. So they called that he was very different, and it seemed he has this crazy streak. And when they talk about genes here, so we've read a little bit about genetics, have we? Yes. And here, although yes, Murad and Uncle Khosrow, they were not like a father and son, but it seemed as if someone who was like Uncle Khosrow in his behavior, it was Murad. Because Murad was like that, very brave and careless, and least bothered about the consequences. Okay? So what have Adam and Murad done? Can anybody tell me? Yes, they are, of course, Murad was there riding a horse, and he has taken Adam to ride the horse along with him. Right? And Adam is quite clever. He realizes that this boy has been, this cousin has been riding a horse for quite some time. And now he wants me to be involved in this crime of his, right? So just like, as I said, you go take the car outside without permission, right? Or you've got, some extra ice cream or something for yourself, or your parents are away and you have a blast. And you involve your brothers and sisters also to make them keep quiet. Bribery, isn't it? You do that or not? Batana nahin, isn't it? So we are there involving others in that crime of ours, right? And when you think about life, it's these little things that make life so beautiful. It's not necessary here you have to set out on a very, risky adventure. Then that is what makes life. Little things that happen in life, little moments of happiness and pleasure. Oh yeah, you feel like I'm taking a big risk, right? Teacher is there teaching in the class, and you are there nicely. You put your mobile in your register and you're scrolling away. Oh my God, I'm the bravest person on earth. Look at me. I take so many risks. This is life, isn't it? That's what you do, right? Or you feel, oh God, the class is there. What will the teacher know? I turn off the video and I go for what? Tell me what you do then. You know better? You go to sleep? Yeah, or I'll have my breakfast now. Or I'll cook something for myself, right? Or the lecture is still going on. I'll go to the market. I have to buy something. Till then, I'll bag. The classes can carry on. But we've done that. And we feel so brave doing all this. Because we love, going against the rules and regulations. And this is your age. Your youngsters, right? This is your age to break rules, right? To have fun. And that is how you will also learn. But when we realize that line that we should not cross. Yeah? You make fun of your friends every day, right? You meet your friends and yeah, you have real fun. Okay, let's, he's come to the class. Let's ask him questions. Let's make fun of him. But there has to be that moment when you realize that I should not cross the line. When it is from friendly teasing to bullying, it just takes a moment, doesn't it? Right? So that is that barrier or that border that you have to realize. This chapter is about that. It's about realizing what is right and what is wrong. So yeah, many instances are going to happen which are going to make Adam and Murad realize their mistake. Okay. Now the biggest incident that happens is that, now I've told about Uncle Khosrow, right? He's known for his craziness. Murad is also known for his craziness, right? Yes, Imanshu? Yeah. Okay. Then here, there's going to be another character in this story. We have John Byron. He's a farmer, right? And he's living with these Armenian people. He's learned to speak their language also. And he knows about this family's reputation, that they are known for their honesty, right? Now what happens is, in these few days or these few months, when Adam and Murad have been riding the horse, John Byron lost his horse. He couldn't find it. And now he's in such a problem, right? Now one day he comes to Uncle Khosrow, he complains that, see, I've lost my horse, it's so difficult. Naturally, how important is the horse to the farmer? In the fields, he'll require it. Maybe for going from one place to another, he might require it. And so he talks about his problem. But Uncle Khosrow, what does he say? Do you think he sympathizes with him? Do you think he understands his problem? No. He says, you've got legs, right? You can walk. You can run. What do you need the horse for? And he says, I have a bigger problem, right? So he does not listen to him. But of course, here one day, as the boys, what did they do early morning? They would go for riding the horse. Yes. And the horse was also quite healthy now because it's getting regular exercise. It's being taken well care of, right? Now, one day, one morning, as they were taking the horse back, they have found an isolated barn where they can hide the horse, right? And they've kept fodder also for the horse. And one day, as they were coming after riding the horse, whom did they meet? John Byron. Who was John Byron? He was the farmer who had lost his horse. When he looked at the horse, not once, but twice, looked at the horse, opened the mouth of the horse, checked the teeth of the horse, and he said, this horse is same as my horse. Right? It's absolutely the same. But he says, but because I know you people cannot do what? A crime. You can't steal because you are honest people. Otherwise, I would have said that this is my horse and I believe this is my horse. But because you are there, I think this horse might be the twin of my horse. So he's very surprised there. After that, what happens is that maybe Adam and Murad, they had a little bit of conscience awakening that they saw John Byron and he did not say anything to them, right? He's recognized his horse. Even then, he did not say anything to them. And then what do? They return the horse, right? And yes, so John Byron comes and tells them that, see, I've my horse has come back and it's very healthy and it's in very good spirits and right. So the boys, they return the horse. It's a simple story about realizing one's mistake, right? But of course here, once again, as we're going to read the story, it is going to be that moment when the boys realize their mistake. If they realize their mistake when John Byron came to them, John Byron reminded them of their family reputation. Similarly, when we are in a classroom all together, we're doing our tests and we don't mind, you know, okay, left, right, front, back, center. wherever we're able to get the answer, us time pe to if we never spoken to that child even for a year, even then that person is our best friend. Tell me the answers, okay? Right? But that time we have no problems at all. And of course, if your teacher points out that I never thought you could do that, I would say I'm very sure about that. There'll be very few of you who will actually feel ashamed of what you're doing. And those who are ashamed of doing such a thing, they'll never do it in the first place, right? So here, when you finish this chapter, this is what I am going to discuss about. It's about realizing what is right and wrong. Do we need others to constantly remind us what is right and wrong? Right? Or should it be within us? Our conscience should tell us. We should have that courage to realize that this is right and this is wrong. Having fun, I told you something different. But owning responsibility is something different. Okay? Right? So I think so. Yeah, I've managed to finish off with the summary of this chapter. But yes, we have to do the reading part. It's very, very important. Okay? Right? Yes?